which is inside the div tag is the child tag of div. So if now if I call the dot string method on this div tag, it will return none object because it has a child tag, which is the span. So we cannot get the text which is written SDFSD because it contains a child tag. So it will return a none object, and I will show it to you later, like how it differs from dot text. After that, dot name is just returns the name of the tag which we are calling, and the syntax is pretty straightforward, but you don't have to remember that as I previously mentioned. After that, we use title dot parent dot name. So this returns us the name of the parent tag, such as if I use parent dot name on the span tag which I mentioned above, so it will return us div because div was the parent tag of the span tag. After that, I do soup dot p. P is the paragraph tag which is used to specify the text most of the times. Like p tag is the abbreviation of paragraph is P here, and it is used for writing the text most of the times. And here P tag has a class introduction. So class is just an attribute of this tag P, and it is used for CSS styling, etc. And just an attribute which is passed on through a P tag. So soup.p returns as the first paragraph tag that it can find on the web page. So as you can see, this is a single P tag. It starts here and it closes here. So this is a simple P tag and the other tags which are within it. So as you can see here, this is the first P tag and it has returned it as it is. So after that, you can also do a dot get function. So it returns the class. So you can specify anything within dot get. You can get any attribute this way. And as I have mentioned, class in the dot get, so it returns me the value of the class attribute which the p tag has. So as you can see, the p tag has the attribute class is equal to introduction. So there are multiple ways of doing the same thing, and like soup.p in brackets class also gives us the same output, just as dot get class. After that, you can also use dot p dot attributes. ATTRS is the short form for attributes, and you here what you get is the dictionary of all the attributes. Like there are multiple attributes in a HTML tag, like ID, href, or class, and many other. Like sometimes there is style also when we use inline CSS styling. So it returns a dictionary, a Python dictionary. This is the format of a Python dictionary. The class here is the key of the dictionary, and introduction is the value. So you can get any, you can get the attributes of any tag in this format. And after that, we can also use dot find class is equal to hoverable. So suppose many, you have to find a particular class which has this class which has this value, class value. So we don't have to search for all the divs and their class names. We can just specify find class is equal to card hoverable. So you might be seeing here the underscore. So this is part of the syntax, and you always have to include it with the class wherever you mention the word class in the LXML parser. So this is part of the syntax, and if I run it, this returns us the div class, div tag. So you might be seeing other this div tag and other div tags and img tag. So these are the child tags of div, of this div which we were supposed to find. So these are also returned within within this, and as a whole it returns the all the contents of the tag which we want to find. Okay, so this is the output of dot find class. So we are finding a particular CSS class here. After that, we can also find the contents if we don't want the class and just the contents of that div tag. So this returns us, as you can see, a list of all the tags or all the text which is within that class. So as you can see, here is first n. So n is used for as it is common in all the languages, I guess, and it is used for spacing and like moving to next line and some like all that functions. So after that, as you can see, all the tags are returned as a part of a list in the form of a list. And after that, so suppose that till now we were finding only one tag. Suppose you want to find all the p tags that are present on the web page. So you can use find all in bracket. You can mention the tag which you want to find. And after that, if I print this, so as you can see, the list of all the p tags is passed on to here. So this is the first p tag separated by comma, then next p tag, and so on. So now I will be taking any questions. If you have any question, you can mention in the chat box. Hello.
Yeah, you
any doubts? If anyone has any doubt, you can unmute your mic and ask it. So I'm assuming there are no doubts. Okay, so someone has asked, what are the difference between different parsers? So there is not much difference if you are using for like only basic stuff. So it just depends on the way you, the output is sent. So here, as I'm using LXML, so the whole code, whole HTML code has been is being sent to us in the output. So if I use HTML parser, so the output will be very similar. Only the formatting will change, or the like you were seeing the end tags here. So in HTML parser, you won't see those end tags, these end tags, because these are not specified in the HTML. These are decoded by the LXML parser because it sees a blank space there. So it is just like a programming language. It converts that white space into end tag. So in HTML parser, you will get the HTML code and won't get this end tag. So the parsers are almost similar for basic usage. I hope I cleared the doubt. As I can see, there are no more doubts. So moving on. So you can also do them. As I said, there are multiple ways to do the same thing. So now now the other way is soup bracket p. So it returns the same output as soup.findAllP was sending us. Like this is the basic output which we are getting. So we can use it in multiple ways as the this is a list only, and we can use it to code in different ways and like get different outputs and play with the output basically. So what I've done is here is I'm iterating through this list element by element for using a for loop and then printing print paragraph.string and paragraph.text. So it will basically print the text of each p tag. So if I run it, so as you can see here, the first is none. So the first p tag here, so it contained child tag. As I mentioned before, the dot string would return a none object if we pass on to an a tag which has child tags. So as you can see, here are the child tags of the p tag. Span tag, and here is the a tag. So these are all the child tags of this p tag. So it will return a none object, but dot text works fine here and returns this text which is contained inside the p tag. As you can see, the whole text is returned as it is, ignoring all the tags which are between it. So moving on, so you can also use soup.text. Like we were using soup.text, you can also use soup.getText. This is just an alternative way of doing the same thing. So it returns the whole text of the web page as it is without any tags, as you can see here. There is no way of like getting a string if there is child tag. So you can basically change to a particular tag. You can get a particular tag, like first get this string of the span child, and then after that a tag. So you can get text of individual child tags and then iterate through. So you can also, like, here was a p tag in returned in a list. So you can also iterate through a single p tag using like here you can use soup.p.findAllTrue, which we will see later. So you can get all the child tags which are present inside a tag, and you can iterate through them and get the text in a string format. So after that, so here is get. So getText has a major function that it can be used to strip all the spaces. Like we were saying, there were many n tags which were returned in the list when we were using the find all function. So suppose you don't want to get those n tags and you just want to get the text. So the function here is this. So as you can see, it returns all the text which is joined by this. So this works as a join operator, just like you have dot join in the Python code, which you can use to join multiple strings. So this works the same way and strips all the spaces and join the different text strings which we have and join them using this symbol. So I can mention anything here. Suppose I do this. So as you can see, the text is joined by this operator now. You can specify any symbol of your choice and get the text in this format. After that, you may want to find all the links which are present in the web page. To do that is like all the links which are present in the web page are in the A tag. In A is equal to href. So if I show you this. So I'm using the inspect element to view the source code of the web page. So as you can see, the beautiful soup4 link is inside the A tag. So all links are present inside the A tag, and the link which we get redirected to after clicking on that text is mentioned inside the href attribute. Href is an attribute of the A tag, and the URL is mentioned inside the href. So what we are doing here is we are iterating through all the A tags present in the web page, and we are doing url.getHref. So as I've shown you earlier, .get can be used to get the classes or the attributes which are present in a tag. So here we are getting the href attribute. So basically what it will do is print all the links which we have. So you must be seeing two types of links here. So the black ones are the local links. Like these are the websites which are created by the owner of this website only and linked locally, like in a server only. These are all his websites. And these are the global URLs like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. So the black ones are the local websites which are created by him. And these are the global URLs. So you get all the URLs here. So you will also get the tags, like sometimes in like, for example, in Wikipedia, when you click on something in the index, you get redirected to that topic in the same page. So it will also show you that links also. So now coming to the next, so you can also do url.text if you want to iterate using a for loop through the text, the link text. So it will give you the text of the link. So here, as you can see, the first link is home, then plus is equal to one, then support the content, community, login. So it gives you in the same order and gives you all the link text. After that, here I'm getting a soup.nav. So nav is the short form for the nav bar. And for those who don't know that what is a nav bar, this is the nav bar. The blue one which you can see here is the navbar, which contains all the home and login buttons, etc. This is known as the navbar. This is a general term. And here I'm getting the navbar, soup.nav, and storing it as an object, as a variable. So if I print the nav, so as you can see, it returns the code of the navbar only. After that, you can also use this. So what I've done is I've stored the navbar inside a variable, and now I'm using the dot find all function onto the navbar. So it will return all the A tags which are present in the navbar only. So for the earlier doubt, which was asked to print the strings of like the objects with tags which have child tags, so you can use this function. You can create a variable of the parent tag and iterate through it and find all the child tags and get the strings. So this is simply returning us the output of all the links present in the navbar here. Okay, so now I will be taking the doubts. If you have any doubt, you can mention in the chat box. Please unmute your mic and ask any doubt if you want. So find all operate on the on any tag or on the soup as a whole. So soup was the whole like HTML tag. HTML tag is the one which contains all the tags which are present. So it can operate on any tag. Like here I've operated it on the nav tag. So it will give me all the tags which are present, all the A tags which are present inside the nav bar. So you can use it on any tag. Any other doubts? So let's move on there. So I'm doing same with the body tag as I did for the navbar. So here, as you can see, I made a variable of soup.body, and then I'm printing all the P tags which are present inside the body. So this is the content. This is the text which is present inside the body, the body tag. So like, you can play with the output as much as you want, and it is limited only by your imagination. And next we get this. So for div in soup.findAll, div class is equal to body. So what I'm doing here is I'm getting all the div tags which have this class and this class value. Okay, so it will return me the div text which is present inside the div is equal to body, div body, div with class of body. You can also use attributes is equal to this. You can pass this instead of class is equal to body. Okay, and you can you can send multiple attributes in here, and you can narrow down your search as much as you want. So after that, we have tag.name. I mentioned dot name before. This will return all of the tags which we have in the web page, name of all the tags, as we are using soup.findAll true. So true, what true will do is it will return all the tags which are present inside. Okay, so you can create functions also like here. So what I'm doing here is I want a tag which has attribute class but not attribute ID. I only want a tag which has class attribute but not ID. So what I'm returning is tag.hasAttribute class and not tag.hasAttribute ID. So this will return true only when the tag has attribute class, and this will return true when it has attribute ID. So as we don't want the ID, we are using and not. So the true becomes false and false becomes true. So after that, we send it into the findAll method, findAll function, and we get all the tags which have class but no ID, as you can see here. So these are all the things which you can do with the web scraping. Like there are multiple more things, like you can use href and not static in href to search for a particular link like if you want like this, return href and not static in href. So it will return all the links which are there present and don't have static in the link. So if I remove static and pass into some random value, so as you can see, these three tags, these three links had static in them. So first they were not visible. So if I change it to earlier, as you can see, those tags are not visible now. Those tags are not included in the output. So you can create multiple functions like this. You can also use a.append bar. So this works the same way like in Python or any other language. Dot append appends this after the adds the string bar after the new link text. But this won't be of any use because this will be only temporary, and if you refresh the web page, it will return to normal again. So you can use soup.prettify also. So what it will do is it will give you the output in a very readable format, like with indentation and all, with proper spacing. So if someone is very like concerned about the indentation and the looks of the output, they can use this function. After that, you can see here there is a table present in the web page. So to iterate through the table, you need to specify the tr and th tags. So first I print out the raw table. So it will be in this format. Inside the table tags, there are three types of tags: tr, th, and td. Tr is specified is used to specify the row. Tr stands for row, and whatever we send into the tr tag becomes a part of that row, of that particular row. So th is used for table heads and is used for specifying the headings of each column, and td is for general tech data which we want in the particular column and row. So now what we will do is we will use table rows is equal to table dot find all tr. So first I have made a variable of the table tag, and then I am finding all the tr tags which are present inside the table. Now I'm using a for loop on the tr and getting each tr, and then using td is equal to tr dot find all td. So first I made a variable of the table, then I found out a particular row in the table, and then I'm using it to find a particular td, a particular data cell in that particular row, and then I'm printing it. So as you can see, this is the format which we have received as the output. So first, the first list is empty, as you can see. So, this is because the first list contained the th tags, and we are using only the td tags. Therefore, this will be empty. So you can also use pandas. For those who know pandas, pandas is a library in Python which is used for particularly for data frames and the tables and all. So it will return us in this format, in a particularly table like format, which is very readable and very convenient for us to like make our statistics and all. So after that, this is the end of the beautiful soup web scraping. So the problem arises is that sometimes we use JavaScript to manipulate the code. Website code, and we change some elements after the page has loaded. So the problem with the beautiful soup is that we are using it in a script or in the Python and like something like that. So the problem is that the JavaScript only runs when it is in the browser environment. So as you can see here, one second. As you can see here, I'm targeting this tag. So it is written look at you shiny. So the problem with the BS4 is that it will return the text which is present at the time the web page ends loading. So it will not allow any JavaScript to run. And as you can see, it will return why you bad though. But the text here was look at you shining. So this is because the JavaScript at the backend is not running, and the tags are not being changed. So it will return us the original tag only. So this might hinder some of the like iteration sometimes. This will return the like false output. So you can use that, use the Selenium for this, because Selenium is for website, web automation. So it will run in a web driver only, like in a browser environment. So we use Selenium for web automation for, like I mentioned before, like filling Google Forms on its own or something like that, booking flight tickets and many more functions. So basically it's for web automation. So what I'm doing here is I'm importing the web driver from Selenium and I'm importing by. So these are the libraries which are being used. WebDriver is a like a library, and by is a function which we will use later. It's not significant right now. So after that, so I'm then specifying driver is equal to WebDriver.Chrome. So I'm specifying the WebDriver to be Google Chrome because I'm using Google Chrome right now. So I'm passing the Chrome into the web driver and telling it to use this web browser for its automation. For this, you need to install the Chrome driver, which is available on the Google Chrome website. I've put that into the dependencies doc, which I sent. You can download it from there. And now I will be taking any doubts. So if you have any doubt, please unmute your mic or specify and write it in the chat. In pandas, why did we only get table? So pandas is used for that only. Pandas is a data frame library, data set library, and is used for manipulating and printing in the data, like in the format of a table only. So that's it. That's its basic usage. Yeah, so web automation is that only, like filling Google Forms by its own or opening any website or searching for a particular website. And like when we will go through the Selenium, we will see what actually web automation means. I'm not able to get this. And you reiterate when BS4 fails. Let's say I'm not able to get what the doubt is. Can you please specify more clearly? Selenium is used for web automation. Don't worry, we will see that in a moment. Seeing that there are no more doubts, I'm assuming I'm moving on then. So now I run this. I'm specifying the Google Chrome in the web driver and I'm sending the URL which I wanted to use for web automation. So when I run this, as you can see, it opens up a web browser on its own. And it loads the website, which the URL which we mentioned in the driver.get. So that's the function which we wanted it to do right now. So after that, these are the basic functions which you can do, like driver.back will take us to the previous page. This is it does the function of this back arrow, the previous page arrow. And after that, you can do driver.forward. It will take you to the forward page. And these are the basic functions. Driver.refresh will refresh the page. Driver.title will give us the output of what is the title of the web page, Python programming tutorials. This is the title of the web page. And driver.current window handle. So current window handle is the key. It is like an ID or a key which is assigned to that tab or to the window. So the web driver does not make distinction between windows and tabs. If your site opens a new tab or window, Selenium will let you work with it using a window handle. It assigns every new tab or a new window a window handle. which you can use to switch to different tabs and some other things like that. So each window has a unique identifier. Okay, so it remains same in a single session. And if you like run the whole code again, like so the window handle might change as it is generated in a sort of random procedure. So now I want to switch to a new window. So I'm specifying driver.switchTo.newWindow in brackets tab. So what this will do is, this will open a new tab for us. So you can also do the same thing with the new window, with a new window. And as you can see here, it opens up a new window for us. So this is the basic functionality. And what you can do here is you can switch to the different tabs or to the different windows and work using multiple tabs. And first I will specify a variable, original window. One second. So what I'm doing here is I'm saving the current window handle, the window handle of this tab, into a original window variable. So after that, if I open the new tabs now and a new window, and then I drew driver.switchTo.window and then mention which window I want to switch to. That's the window handle of the original, the Python programming tutorials window we had. And when we, one second. I think there is a problem. One second. You can also use driver.close to close a particular web, a particular window or a tab which you are currently working on. Right. So now I use switchTo.window original window. As you can see, it switched to the original window we had from the tab which we were working on currently. So you can also use a for loop to iterate through different current window handles we have through a different tabs or through the different windows we have currently, and then go to a particular tab using this. So what I'm doing here is I'm iterating through the window handles which are present currently, and if window handle not equal to original window, then we want to switch that window. So if I run it, you can see it moved to the other tab. So as we were specifying window handle not equal to the original window, so it moves to the next tab which was which had window handle not equal to the current window. So I assume that it might be difficult for you to like keep up with the syntax and all, but you don't have to remember the syntax and the like formatting. You just have to know what's the like, what's the output, what the usage, what we can do. Okay, so on opening a new tab, why isn't the web page opening in that window? That's because we are only opening a new window. Like you can see here, driver.switchTo.newWindow. We are not specifying any URL which we want to go to. So if I do this and after that I specify driver.get this, so it will move to that URL there. We are not specifying any URL here, so it just opens a blank tab or a blank window. So after that, So I imported the by function, which I told you earlier. So by is used to select a particular tag by using different methods. So as you can see here, I'm using driver.findElement by.linkText. So linkText, as I mentioned earlier, linkText is the text which is converted into a link. So for example here, the beautiful soup 4 is a link text, and the link will be after I click it, you can see this is the link, and beautiful soup 4 is the link text. So I want to find element by dot link text, and I want to find the element which has this as the link text, beautiful soup 4. And if I run this, as you can see, it opens a web page. One second. Element click intercept. One second, please. Okay, so the problem is that, so I was going to take the topic later, but as we have encountered the problem now only, so what is happening is that as you can see, it will pass us an error that element click intercepted. So why is it sending us that? So the problem is that the Selenium surfs through the only the top of the website. So it will not go into any frames or iframes or something like that. And as you can see, this sign up option is coming over the beautiful soup 4. So it is not able to find the element by link text. As you can see, the sign up is above this link text, so it will not be able to find this. And if somehow we will be able to remove this, then it can click on it. So let me specify some other link text. So now I'm specifying home, so let's see if it clicks it now. As you can see, as soon as the web page is loaded, it clicks on the home button. So if we go back, so this is the home page, and it clicks on the home button. So like the click was being intercepted by this sign up button. So I will tell you later how to cope with this. That can be like solved very easily, but I will take that up later. So what I want to do next is I want to find the element by dot tag name p, and then for each tag that we get as the output, I want to print the text which is text. So if I do that, the web page is loading, and after that it returns us all the link text, all the not link text, all the paragraph text which we had in the web page. So as you can see here, all the text is returned as the output. And now, like the original problem which we started with was the you bad though and the look at you shining problem. So it will now solve the problem because it is operating in a browser environment. So as you can see, the output is now look at you shining. But in the case of the beautiful soup library, as you can see here, the output was why you bad though. I'm using the same class to select the tag. As you can see here, class is equal to JS test and the tag is P. And here also the tag by class, I'm specifying the tag by the class name and using JS test to find the element. So now I will take doubts. If you have any, you can unmute your mic or write it in the chat box. I know the syntax will be hard to like catch, but try to like get what's the output, the format of the output, what are the different features which you can do, functions you can perform. Don't really get bothered by the syntax. If you have any doubt, please write it in the chat box, or you can also unmute your mic. Okay, one by one. Okay, so what thing was intercepting? So like I mentioned here, this, the sign up button which we have here is intercepting the beautiful soup. So as it is over the beautiful soup for, so the click will get intercepted. So as you can see here, I also cannot click on the beautiful soup for because it is below the sign up button. So this is the tag which is intercepting the click. Next, should the chromedriver.exe be in the same file location as, no, the chromedriver.exe should be in a file location that can be accessed by the Python. So it is not necessary that you keep in the same location as the notebook. So I've kept it in the, like, I've gone into C, then Windows, and I've placed it there. So in a very random location. So there is no relation of the location with the functionality. Can you explain again why we didn't get look at you shining in the BS4 before? Okay, so the problem is that, wait, let me show you the script. So this is the script. So we have the P tag, we have and P tag class is equal to JS test, and we have specified why you bad though. Okay, so first time when the page loads, this will be why you bad though. But we have also mentioned the JavaScript script tag is used for mentioning the writing the JavaScript code. So we are using document.getElementById. This is the JavaScript JavaScript syntax. So we get the this element by ID. This element has this ID. We are using the to find the element by using the ID, and then we are using dot inner HTML. So what inner HTML does is it changes the content which is present inside that tag. So the dot inner HTML will change the value bad though with this. So this will replace this, but only in the browser environment, because this is the basis of JavaScript, that it will only run in the browser environment when we load the page in the browser, and it will not run if any scripting is being used. So JavaScript needs a browser environment, and as we were using the Python script in beautiful soup, so it was indirectly like we were taking only the code, only the tags which were present inside the web page, and we were not really loading the web page. Okay, so that problem is solved by Selenium, because as you saw, the Selenium loads the web page first in the web browser and then gets the text. Okay, so now is it clear? Can you please reply in the chat if everything is clear? Okay. And Rahul Singh, not clear. Can you please specify what part was not clear specifically? Hello, Rahul Singh? Okay, fine. So we should move on now. No problem. So as I mentioned earlier, so the problem is that Selenium only serves through the web page. It will not go into any particular iframe or something like that. So I've created a simple code here this is the code which I've put in a HTML page. I will show you the HTML page now. This is the HTML page which I've created for the demo. And as you can see, I've created an iframe. Iframe is like a frame in the web page, and I've put a Selenium documentation web page inside the iframe. So the problem with Selenium is that it will find any element which I tell it to on the web page, and it will not go into the particular iframe and search in that. For the Selenium web driver, this particular web page which is being loaded inside the iframe is a different web page, and it will not go into that iframe to search for elements. It will only search on the code which is present. So as you can see here, is I'm sending iframe, and then I'm loading a web page inside it. So the Selenium web driver will not know what is inside this tag or something like that. So it will not be able to find the elements which I've asked it to on that web page. So what I'm targeting is I'm asking it to click on this menu button. But first you will see it loads the web page, and it will pass an error that no such element was found, because this was our original code and there is no such button in the like drop down which has ID drop down in our code. So it will not be able to find any element of such ID. So what we have to do is we have to switch to the frame. So this is particularly for iframes. I don't think there are any other tags or any other functionalities which hinder like this. This is particularly for iframes. These are known as iframes, which where you can put any type of text or any type of like for in inside the iframe, any web page, any text, any buttons, etc. So I'm selecting the the iframe using this. This is just the syntax by dot CSS selector. So this is the syntax of the CSS. When we use CSS styling for the HTML web page, then we select the elements using this format. So what I'm doing here is, so if I show you the code, so this is the code, and the parent tag has the ID model. So we are selecting the iframe which is present inside the model. It is not really necessary here, because this is the single iframe which is present in the web page. So if I mention only iframe, then also it works fine. So now I'm using, I've stored it in the variable iframe. Then I use driver.switchTo.frame iframe. This is just a syntax which you don't have to remember again. So I'm switching to the iframe. It's many of you are well-versed with Python from the poll that I sent earlier. I have reduced that. So you have scopes in a function, right? In a scopes in the code, different scopes like global scope or function scope. So this is basically like we are switching to a particular scope. And it is similar to that. We cannot use variables from a particular scope outside of that scope. So it is similar to that, and we cannot find the elements, the tags which are present inside the iframe, and we have to go into that scope. We have to go into that frame to search for the elements. So now if I run it, so this switch to the iframe, so it will not be visible. It will not make any visible change. But now if I do driver by dot ID drop down button and click it, so as you can see, it clicks the button. First, it was not able to locate the element, but now we have switched to the iframe and it is now able to find the button and it's able to click it. So if you want to switch to the default content, so you can simply do switch to dot default content and it will switch to this. So I want to close the button also. So this is another way of finding the element. So you don't have to specify any CSS selector or model. This is particularly for the iframe. And as you can see here in the code, the iframe has ID button frame. So I will use the ID directly to switch to the button frame. So as you can see here, I'm using driver.switchTo.frame button frame. This is this method specifically for iframes, and then I will do driver.findElementby.id dropdown, and this will directly click it again, and I will switch to default content again. This is another way of switching to frames. So frames are also accessible through like indexing. Each frame on a web page is indexed with a particular number, like you have in a Python list. So the numbering again starts from zero. So I only have one iframe in this on this web page, so I specify the switch to dot frame zero. So this selects the first iframe which is present. So as I have only one, so this will work fine for. So now I switch to default content. I see there's a doubt, I guess. Yeah, the default content is the global scope. Yeah, so if I'm making that analogy, so the default content is the global scope, and default content contains all the tags which are present inside the HTML page. Okay, so moving on. So these are some of the other functions. I don't think these are very necessary for web automation, but still I think that I should tell you about these functions. So basically it's like getting the width and height of the browser window which we have. So width is equal to driver.getWindowSize.getWidth. So this will give us the width of the web page which we have, and .getHeight will give us the height of the web browser which we have. And if I print it, so currently the web page is at 1050, 180. As you can see, I have resized it so that you can see both of these. So it is not the full screen size. The full screen size will be 1920. So now you can set the size also to a particular size. Like I have mentioned 1024, 768. So 1024 will be the x coordinate, like the width, and 768 will be the height of the web browser. So if I run it, so as you can see, so you won't be seeing any significant change because the browser size was almost the same, like it changed in some 20 or 30 pixels. So now if I run it, so as you can see, the web browser size was changed. Okay, so you can also get the window position. So like you have in many almost all Python libraries, you have the coordinate system a bit different. So the origin is not at the left bottom corner, it is at the left top corner. So this is the case with most Python libraries. And one second. So the origin is at the top left corner of the screen or of the window which we are using. So this is common for all Python libraries. And now if I get do dot get x and dot get y, so it will return me the position of the minimum distance between this and this. So this will return us the coordinates of this point because this is the nearest to the origin. So as you can see, this is the 611, this is the x coordinate, and 253 is the y coordinate. So the y-axis also is downwards and not upwards. The positive y-axis faces downwards in case of Python libraries, and the coordinate system is a bit different therefore. So you can also now set the window position. So I have done window position 0,0, and as you can see, it goes to 0,0. So this is problem, like you can see a gap here. So that is a problem of my screen. I've configured it a bit differently. So if you use it on your screen, so it will perfectly align with the screen edge. Okay, so next, you can also maximize the window, minimize the window, or even full screen window. So these are the functions which you will like almost never get the need of. These are almost never used, but it's good to know like we can do such things with the Selenium. So also the now the topic which I will take is that a little more advanced, and you will probably not need it while doing the basic stuff. So these are the weights. So there are two type of weights: implicit weight and the explicit weight. So why do we need weights actually? So the problem is that the Selenium is asynchronous. Advanced concepts of Selenium, not all advanced concepts of Selenium, are asynchronous with the web page. What asynchronous means is that they will not wait for the web page to load. So sometimes you have a poor internet connection, that one bit, what will happen, the page will take a very huge time to load the contents completely. And sometimes the problem is that the images are very high resolution and of very large size, so they take a lot of time to load. So the problem is that the Selenium will surf through the web page, and it when it finds no element of that type, it will just pass on an error. So this is not the problem with the basic stuff, because the dot find element or dot click are mostly synchronous, and they wait for the content to load completely. But if you go a little deep into the Selenium, like explore some advanced concepts, so you will need to use the implicit and explicit weights. They are very important, otherwise you will get a timeout error, or like the element was not found, or element is not enabled, and like errors like that. So first I will tell you the basic functions which we have. So we have L is displayed and L is enabled. So there are many other like that, is clickable, or it contains text and something like that. So these are Boolean functions. So as the name suggests, these will return true. This will return true, is displayed will return true when the element is being displayed. So it will return true when the element is being displayed, and this will return true when the element is enabled. So L using is enabled with buttons makes sense only, because if you are using with some text or all, then it will always send you true, because they are always enabled. So sometimes the case is that in some login pages the login button is not enabled until you have filled all the information. So this is used to detect those features, and you can easily get the required output. So if the button is not enabled, then it will just return false here. So I'm using now youtube.com. And I'm finding the by.tag name, and I'm finding span, the span tag with ID title. So now the element which I am finding is, I will show it to you. Actually, it is the recommended tag. It is not a tag, actually it is the text. So if I do inspect element, this. So I am finding this element with this tag span and the ID title. So as you can see, this particular tag is enabled, is displayed, and also as it is just text tag, so it is enabled also, and it returns true for both. And this is another function. So basically, this is not of Selenium. Assert is used in general Python, and assert is simply like using if l.text is equal to recommended. So this like compares the l.text and recommended. And if I do something like this to give you a better idea of what is happening, the content loads, and as you can see, it passes an assertion error because this is false. L.text is equal to recommended and not this random string. So it will pass an assertion error, and you can use this to find the base, like search for text which we have in the web page and something like that. You can use it in a for loop and search for a particular text and use it with regular expressions. If you know about what are regular expressions in Python, you can use this along with the regular expressions. So now we come to the weights which I mentioned earlier. So before that, I will be taking doubts. If you have any, please mention in the chat box or unmute your mic and ask, please. The syntax will be quite too much for the first timers, but believe me, you don't have to remember the syntax. It is perfectly searchable on the internet, and you can easily find the documentations. Like if I show you the documentation, it is quite good, and it mentions all the... One second, let me go to documentation. So it will go give you all the codes, and it will also explain you the implementation and explain each function and all. So it is perfectly searchable. You don't have to remember any of the syntax. Is there any doubt or should I move on? Okay. Difference between implicit weight and explicit weight. So I have not told it till now. So implicit weight is like, we are mentioning the time, the wait time for each command. So implicit wait applies to each command which we pass on to the Selenium driver. So as you can see here, I have used multiple commands. So implicit wait will apply to each of these commands and will apply the wait timer to each of these. So as you can see here, the syntax is this. The syntax of implicit wait is quite simple. So I'm using driver.implicitly wait for 10 seconds. So this waits for the command to, for the, like if I use find.find element, okay? And the content has not loaded till now. So it will wait for 10 seconds for the content to load. And after 10 seconds, it will pass a timeout error if the content, is not still not found. Okay, so this is the usage of implicit wait. Okay, so the value which I send in the implicit wait function is the time in seconds for the maximum time which I want the command to wait for the content to load. So you won't need it for the basic stuff which you do. So it does not matter much because the dot find element and dot click and other syntax which I use, other commands which I use, waits for the content to load on their own. So you do not need implicit wait actually, the waits in general actually. It is used for only advanced stuff. Or the second usage is that if you have very poor internet connection, that the content is taking too much time to load. So implicit wait applies to all the commands, and like it's setting a timeout clock to all the commands, and if the content loads within 10 seconds, so it is not like it will give you it will execute the command after 10 seconds only, like the case with time.sleep in Python. It will wait for the maximum of 10 seconds, and if the content loads before the timeout, then it can execute the command at 5 seconds, 4 seconds or 6 seconds also. It will not wait till 10 seconds there. So as a whole, it waits for the content to load for a maximum of 10 seconds and for a minimum of 0 seconds. Okay, so this is the implicit wait, and explicit wait is a bit different. So explicit wait is that we are waiting for a particular condition to be true. Like this is the syntax of explicit wait. It is quite complex. And here we are first importing web driver wait. So like implicit, implicit weight was directly using implicitly weight. Explicit weight is no such syntax, no such tag, no such function, and it uses the web driver weight. So we are using web driver weight driver, the web driver which we are using, timeout, the maximum timeout like we mentioned in the implicit weight, and then until some condition. So we have expected conditions, ECs, which are passed on to the until function. So it waits for those conditions to be true. So some of the ECs I have mentioned here, alert is present, element exists, element is visible, title contains, title is, element stateness, etc. So I've also provided the link to you. So these are the ECs, different ECs which are present. Okay. If these are the different ECs, expected conditions, which you can use in your code. So now moving back to our code. So first I initialize the explicit weight and I use weight is equal to web driver weight driver comma 10. So driver is the web driver which we are using and 10 is the maximum timeout, which we specify, like it's a maximum time which for which the explicit wait will wait for the content to load, for the condition to be true exactly. So after that, we use element dot element wait dot until EC dot element to be clickable. So EC, I've imported expected conditions as EC. EC dot element to be clickable. And then I'm for this particular tag, I'm using by.xpath. So most of you might not know about what is xpath. So xpath is a particular, like we have other tags like other URLs. So xpath is like a path for every tag which is present in the website. So let me show you. So let's go to a particular tag. And as you can see here, this is a particular tag. So I want to copy it. So I go to copy by XPath, copy XPath. And it will look something like this, a random string sort of thing. So I mostly use XPath only because it is unique for every element. And it is much faster than using IDs or classes, etc. And more fail safe in my view. So it returns the output then. So it waits for the element to be clickable. So here I'm using Expedia, the Expedia website. And for this, to show you the functionality, I'm using time.sleep because otherwise it will click very fast and you won't be able to see the output. So now if I run this, so it loads the page. And after 2 seconds, it clicks on this. So this is the element which I have selected using the XPath. And you won't feel the difference here because the weights don't have any visible effect on the functionality. So you won't be able to see the difference between not using a weight and using a weight. So you can use it on your own and try if you can increase the weight limit to too much and see an like too small and see an error, timeout error or something like that. But the functionality won't be visible here. Okay, so it waits for the condition to be true, element to be clickable, and then after that it clicks on it. element.click. It waits until the condition is true and after that it clicks. So is selected can also be used to know if the checkbox is already selected. There are multiple ECs which you can use, but the problem is that you should never mix the two weights. So if you mix explicit weight and implicit weight, you might think that 10 seconds of one and 10 seconds of other will amount to 20 seconds, but it's not the case. Most of the time it results in an ambiguous output, and it is never advised to mix both the weights. Okay, So you should always use one of the weights, either use implicit weight or explicit weight. So I know this was a little bit tricky, the weights. So if you have any doubt, you can ask in the chat box or unmute your mic. Seeing that there are no doubts, so I should move ahead. So now we come to the input boxes, sending text and all. So that is the like main advantage of using Selenium. Implicit weight doesn't wait for any condition to be true. Implicit weight is similar to time.sleep and it waits for a maximum 10 seconds for the whole content to load. Implicit wait doesn't wait for a particular element. Implicit wait waits for the whole content to load and it will wait for the command to execute. So suppose I use it before the dot find element. So if I mention implicitly wait before this dot find element, and if it is not able to find this element currently because the page is loading, so it will wait for 10 seconds, maximum of 10 seconds, as I've mentioned in the implicitly wait. So it will wait for the maximum time, which I said, and after that it will send a timeout error if the element is still not findable. So you can say that implicit wait waits for a particular command. So if dot find element is not able to find the element, so it will wait till the find element is being executed. So it will wait for a particular command and not a particular condition. We are almost in the end. So we now come to the input boxes. So input boxes are similar to like searching for any other element, and you can select any input box using the .xpath, my.xpath. So for this demonstration, I will be using google.com. So this is the general syntax of sending a text into the input box. So I'm sending search box is equal to driver.findElement, my.xpath, and I'm specifying the search box which we have in the google.com. And I'm then sending search box.sendKeys Tinkerer's Lab. So if I do this, it will type, and after that I forgot to mention I'm also using the like you see here Google search. So I'm also selecting the Google share, selecting the Google search button, and I am clicking it there. So it searches for a particular text and then clicks on the Google search. So sometimes the problem is that the element gets intercepted, as you have seen before. So if I add a time.sleep, so you can see the drop-down menu pops up, and after that, the Google search button is not visible. So the click is intercepted, as you can see, element click intercepted. So the solution for this is, so most of the times when you enter text, you can directly press enter, right, to search. So we can do that similarly here. So what we are doing is we are importing keys. So keys is the function which is used to send the non-alphanumeric and symbolic keys like shift, enter, control, backspace, escape, etc. So it is used to send those type of keys. And as you can see here, we search box.sendKeys Tinkerer's Lab, and after that time.sleep, and after that search box.sendKeys keys.enter. So it will just press the enter key. If I show you the demo here, it will load, and after 2 seconds it will press enter. So you can use this method to avoid the click intercepts in case of drop down menus in search buttons. So after that, the next topic is action chains. So this is also not that important. Action chains is like sometimes you have to press shift plus some key to make it capital, or press control A to select all the text. So you can do this using action chains. So as the name suggests, action chains creates a chain of the actions, chain of key actions. And as you can see here, I am specifying this webdriver.actionChains. I am passing the driver into it. And then I'm specifying action.keyDown, keys.control, sendKeys, a.perform. So this is the general syntax. Again, you don't have to remember this. And it will just keyDown means it will keep the control key pressed. And after that, it will press the A key. So if I show you the demo. So as you can see, this selects the whole text. So you can use action chains to create a combination of keys. So after that, this is the functionality. So first you should see the output. So we are using QWERTY in capitals, then small, and then we are clearing the input. So we can do this using, as you can see here, key down, keys.shift, then we are sending the keys. So we are sending the text while keeping the shift key pressed. And after that, we are removing the shift key and then again sending the keys. So first it will do shift plus text and after that without shift text. So as you saw in the output, first the QWERTY was capital and after that it was in small. So how do you remove the text? That it's very simple, and you can just do search box dot clear and it clears all the input which you have sent previously. So after that we come to the alerts. So sometimes the problem is that you might have noticed some alerts pop up. So I've created a small demo page for you. So if I click on try it, so these alerts are meant for stopping the bots from scraping the web page. So the problem is that the Selenium won't be able to override this, and we like we did in iframe, we have to switch to this alert frame and then do alert.accept. So first we are clicking the button which we had try it, which the name try it, and after that we are switching alert driver.switch to dot alert. We are switching to the scope of the alert. Then we are printing alert.text, the text which is present in the alert box. And after that, we are using alert.accept. You can also use, like here, after 2 seconds, it clicks on OK. You can also use alert.dismiss here because most of the time it asks for cookies and all. So you can use dismiss.dismiss also. And as you have switched to the frame of the alert, you can also check any boxes. Sometimes there are check boxes present inside the alert box. You can also do that, manipulate the, sometimes there are text boxes also, so you can do that everything like we did in the for a web page. So the next would be the select. Sometimes we have a drop down select list like here. So this is a drop down select list. This is created using a select tag. As you can see here, select tag, and we have option value, and then option text. So option value and option text both can be used for getting the option selected. So we use dropdown.driver.findElementby.idCars. So if I show you again, the select has name and ID cars. So it has the ID attribute of cars. So we are selecting using the by.id and we are selecting the select tag. So after that, we using DRP is equal to select drop down X. So the problem is that the select only works for the select text, only for the select tag. And you can select the select tag using this syntax, select and in brackets dropdown. Dropdown is the driver.findElement. And after that, you can use select by index or select by visible text or select by value. So select by index is the same 0, 1, 2, 3, the numbering, the index which we have, it starts from 0. And after that, we have select by visible text, the text which is printed onto the option, and select by value. As you saw earlier, the each option has a value. So if I run all this. So first is select SAB. As it is the second option, we have sent the first. the first index, and after that, if we do select by visible text, one second, so it will select Mercedes. If we do select by value, it will select out. So after that, you can also print the options which are present using this simple like drp.options. It is the syntax for printing all the values which we have if you want it for reference. And the last topic which we have is scrolling. So sometimes you want to scroll the web page to a particular element to click it. So the first is by pixels. So sometimes you want to scroll it by pixels, but most of the times it doesn't have any use, because it's of no use to scroll by a particular pixel length. Okay, so what I'm doing here is execute script. So this is the syntax for executing a JavaScript. So this is the JavaScript code, windows.scrollby. Again, you don't have to remember, this is available on the Selenium website. You can see the documentation. And then I'm sending 0.1000. So 0 is the scrolling in width, in x direction. This scrolling is specified here, and in 1000, the scrolling which is specified is this. Okay, so I'm specifying 1000. I want to scroll by a pixel length of 1000. If I run that, so as you can see, it scrolls down by a pixel length of 1000. Okay, so you can also do something like this. So the second type of scroll is if you want to scroll until a particular element is in view. Okay, so first I find the element using dot find element, and after that I use this. Okay, so driver dot execute script, argument 0, scroll into view, and then I pass into the element which I want to find until scrolling. So this is very complex syntax and requires JavaScript, but you can directly copy from the documentation and modify the element, just the element which you want to find. And actions is equal to action chain driver and actions dot context click. So what I've clubbed it with the scrolling is this. So context click is another name for right click. So if you want to do right click, you can do actions dot context click dot element and specify the element on which you want to do the right click, and dot perform. Dot perform is simply executing the action chain. So if I do this now, it scrolls until the Chandigarh, Punjab, this text is into the view, and after that it clicks on it, right clicks on it. So that is perfectly what I wanted to do. And you can also do actions dot double click, move to element, or drag and draw features. There are many such features which are present in the action chains. So with this, we come to the end of the today's session. If you have any doubts, you can ask. And now Aniket will take the quiz. It is a very short quiz. Aniket?
Yeah, thanks Bhuvan for such a great session. Now I'll be taking the quiz for what Bhuvan has taught us. So the quiz will be very interactive, and it will just make you revise the things you have learned today. Don't panic if you don't remember anything. It's just to just revise your memory and not any graded quiz. So, but it will be taken for attendance purpose. Now I'll be sharing my screen to start the quiz. Yeah, so I'll be sharing the link. The link for the quiz, you can enter the game code or by that, or you can just go to the link. I've given that in the chat box. After that, we'll also be taking the doubts. We will also be sharing some feedback form quickly. So, refer to that too. Finally, if anybody is having trouble joining in, let me know. Join with your real name as it will be marked for attendance purpose. And now I'll be starting the quiz. Make sure to fill the feedback form. It helps for us. You have missed a quiz, we can mark your attendance via that too. The session is over after you have given the quiz and filled up the feedback form. But if you have any doubts, you can stay and ask them. We are here for clearing your doubts.
Please make sure to fill the feedback form which we have sent in the chat.
Everyone. So the session is over, so you can just fill the feedback form and leave. If you have any doubt, feel free to ask now. Unmute your mic and ask your doubts.